Hi friends, this video consists of both March 19th and March 20th editorials. Hi friends, this video consists of both March 20th and March 21st editorials. Now, starting with the March 20th newspaper, there were nothing much important editorials except one, which is called the Heckler's Veto. Now, let's look into this editorial. Now, going by the definition of what is Heckler's veto, see, Heckler's veto, according to the legal scholars, it is a process by which, you know, socially powerful groups, they can, you know, shut down and something like critical or inconvenient speech by threatening the public disorder or disturbance. So the socially, there'll be few socially powerful groups which can threaten, you know, to shut down the critical or inconvenient speech by one person or a group of person by, you know, by threatening the public disorder or disturbance. Now, one of the ways in which the lower courts can increase the Heckler's veto is by granting an ex parte injunction against the publication or broadcast of news. So there might be a few instances where lower courts can, you know, increase the Heckler's veto by ordering or stopping the publication or broadcast of news. So as we've seen in many cases, like the in case of the artist like M.F. Hussain, and other examples like the Salman Rushdie satanic verses, and also the forced exile from writing for the Perumal Murugan from Tamil Nadu, and also pulping off earlier biography of the former Tamil Nadu Chief Minister Jayalalitha, which was written by Vasanthi, are some of the, you know, few cases. What is happening is it's actually threatening the freedom of speech. So it's threatening the freedom of speech and expression. So this threatening is coming from the, you know, socially powerful sections who could use their proximity to administrative power and the lacuna in our judicial systems with a sense of entitlement and impunity. So what is that first thing is that they use their closeness to the proximity to the administrative power, and also they make use of the lacuna in the our judicial, you know, and the judicial systems in order to shut down the freedom of speech and expression by few groups who have the, you know, different opinion. Now, coming to the analysis, see, a liberal tolerance of a different point of view, it causes no damage. So it only means that, you know, there will be a greater self-restraint, and diversity in expression of views, whether in writings, paintings or visual media, they increase the debate, and the debate should never be shut down. So what is happening is you are by using this Heckler's veto, the socially powerful groups are, you know, trying to shut down the debate. This also shows that they don't have the greater self-restraint on themselves. So this was the summary of this editorial. Now let's move on to the March 21st editorial. Now moving on to the next editorial, which is the Pakistan's headcount. This editorial speaks about the recent Pakistan government decision to launch a national census. So since past 19 years, there have been no census in Pakistan. Now, the allowing census is a welcome step because coming to the significance of census, first it helps us to formulate policies which is more suitable to the demography, and also it is very helpful in the resource allocation. Plus in the delimitation of the constituency. And also with that, the census, it also provides information on various key indicators such as population density. So it gives us information regarding the population density and regarding the gender ratio, and plus the literacy rate, gender ratio, literacy rate, and financial conditions and employment numbers. So these are the significance of the census. Plus, there was also the reason for the Pakistan, you know, very firm on its decision to launch a national census. Maybe it's also because of the recent pressure by the court order. Now, coming to the challenges that could be faced by the Pakistan government, for example, you know, there has been massive influx of people into the Sindh. So, while the population growth in Punjab is slowing down, so, but this political parties in Sindh may say that many Sindhis in rural area, rural Sindh may not be counted as they do not have the national identity card. So, due to the population influx in Sindh, people might say that the you know, many will be left out of the census because they don't have valid identity cards. And also in Punjab, you know, Punjab, they have the fear that the current edge they have in the Pakistan's politics on the strength of democracy, on strength of demographics may be diminished. So they have that fear, and in Balochistan, you know, local political groups, they demand that process be delayed till hundreds of thousands of Pakistan refugees are returned to the Afghanistan. Sorry, till the thousands of Afghan refugees are returned to the Afghanistan, and the refugees have been excluded from the process of following a ruling by Baluch High Court. So now they already the Pakistan Afghanistan refugees are excluded from the national census following the court ruling, and in Khyber Pakhtunkhwa, the tribal groups have opposed the census, citing the reverse migration of locals and influx of Afghan refugees. So there might be various challenges faced by the various regions, put up by the various regions. Like, for example, the Pakistan may oppose census, feeling that, you know, their power would be diminished after the census, which they enjoy due to their demographics, based on their demographics. And now there are also claims by various regions saying that there are many Afghanistan refugees. So first, after they move to their country, the census should be conducted. So these are the various challenges. But what is needed is, see, these challenges will always be there. So given the influence of the ethnic groups and the provincial straps in politics, so but you know, this pressure should not delay the critical administrative decision. So census is not merely an exercise of counting heads. Since it has many significance, it's better not to delay the process of census. Now, given the Pakistan situation, Pakistan is more stable now, both economically and politically. And you know, the government does not face any essential challenges, and it's said to become the second elected government in Pakistan history to finish the full term year. So given the stability in Pakistan, it's better to carry out the census right now. So this was a summary of this editorial. Now moving on to the next editorial. The next editorial is regarding Russia. The title is Sound Furry But Not Much Clout. This is regarding the Russia's foreign policy and its growing influence among the other countries, and it's the question is, really, is it in the verge of becoming the world power, given the uncertainty in USA? Now, looking into the article, the first para speaks about how Russia is smaller economically and demographically smaller than other countries. It says that it is economically smaller than Italy, Australia or South Korea. And also it says that the economy has indeed shrunk over past two consecutive years, and income per capita, it's below that of Malaysia and or Slovakia. And male life expectancy is worse than in Northern Korea. So this is a comparison of Russia between between other countries. But it says that even though Russia, you know, it seems far lower in other areas, when you compare the Russia with other countries in various sectors, but Russia is trying to emerge itself, you know, emerge as the world power with the growing influence on various countries. Now I've taken few important countries and its relationship with the Russia. First, let's look into Ukraine. Russia has annexed the Crimea and has controlled a swathe of eastern Ukraine through proxy rebels. And it also, so with Ukraine, so there has been, you can say, little success with the annexation of Crimea. But you know that Russia was successful to create a wedge between the Turkey and European countries in this Syrian issue. And Russia has the, you know, access to the military facilities in countries like Syria, Iran and Egypt, and it is also, you know, deepening the ties with Western allies like from Israel to Japan. So there has been strengthening of the ties with the Western allies like from Israel to Japan. So this was the positive things, but when you, and other positive thing is like it has helped the Syria and also the, you know, regaining of Aleppo in Syria with the help of the Russian army, Russian military facility. So these are the positive contributions of Russia. Now coming to the other negatives, and one more thing I missed out, other is the Russian influence in other country called Libya. So Russia has been, Russia has, you know, put out special forces in Libyan border. So it has deployed the special forces in the Libyan border. So this is the another growing influence of the Russia. Now coming to the negatives, let's see the negatives. First, let's take in case of US, Russia and USA. There has been, you know, there has been allegations that Russia has, you know, meddled with the US elections. Therefore, it, you know, it is like now the Congress is Congress is against Russia, so that's making it very hard for, you know, to bring out any bargain with the USA. So this has those now somewhat there. Even though the Donald Trump is in favor of Russia, but they still can't bring out the huge bargains for Russia given the protest in USA itself. Now coming to the Afghanistan, for now the Afghanistan saying that, you know, the Russia's interest coincide or it's, you know, it's matching with that of the Taliban interest. So it is pursuing Afghanistan to involve Taliban, to include Taliban in the talks. And also, you know, the trilateral talks which included Russia, China and Afghanistan, China and Pakistan, excluding Afghanistan. So this has not gone well with the Afghanistan. And now coming to the contribution, Russia has tried to exaggerate the IS influence in Afghanistan, and it is trying to, and you know, the main aim is to weaken the US and discredit what it has actually a remarkable successful of US Afghan counterterrorism efforts. So it is trying to, by exaggerating the IS influence in Afghanistan, what is Russia is trying to do is that it is trying to weaken the US and discredit its efforts or discredit its contribution in Afghanistan. Now coming to the reality, the US is there is still, you know, almost 14,000 troops in Afghanistan by the NATO, and there are zero troops contributed by Russia in Afghanistan. So therefore, there is more influence of USA in Afghanistan compared to Russia. Now coming to the China, even though there has been strengthening of the ties with the China, with the naval exercises, etc. And coming to Pakistan, Russia has developed in relationship with the Pakistan by selling its 4 attack helicopters, and also it has pushed aside India's concern regarding the joint drill, and it is ready to go for the joint drills with the Pakistan. And coming to India, so Russia and India partnership is a very significant one. And now coming to economically, Russia has been contributing, there will be an second nuclear submarine to India and also S-400 air defense system to India. So this is a significant contribution by Russia to India, but still, you know, these are the important contributions to South Asian countries like China, Pakistan, India. But what is there economically is that other than its military, other than its defense, other than its defense influence, there's nothing much Russia can contribute economically. Because we've seen that in past 2 years, the economy is slowing down. Because now China and its initiative like One Belt, One Road initiative and India looking for the outside countries for the investment, Russia cannot contribute much economically other than its defense industries. So, and even Pakistan, Russia is limited in providing the concessionary terms for significant defense sales to Pakistan, because even because Russia itself is under economic pressure. So given this, there's not much contribution that can be made by Russia. And also, if you take its defense industries, now there is a growing competition by the US and Israel. So what we've seen that is that, you know, the Russia has created power only where it has been able to change the facts on the ground, usually by force of arms, or only where larger, richer and more coercive Western forces have abstained. So in that area, Russia is trying to create its influence, and economically it's not able to contribute much to the world countries. So even though it feels like Russia is rising in the world scenario, but what is happening is the rise is just a superficial, not much substance in it. So this is a summary of this editorial. Now let's move on to the next editorial. Now moving on to the next editorial, which is framing the right prescription. This editorial speaks about the Indian government's contribution in the health sector. So India spends almost close to 5% of its GDP on health. Even though it's less, but it's not unusually low, but it's okay. What is more worrying thing is that India's performance on the health related sustainable development goals India is ranked almost, you know, 143 out of 188 countries. Now, there's need to look into this for the lower ranking. So, the reason for this lower ranking can be because of two factors. One is that, so let's assume this to be a government. So, one is regarding the pooling of the health expenditure. Pooling of health expenditure. And other thing is control on the health institutions, institutional systems. First let's look into the pooling of health expenditure. First is that see, first of all, our tax to GDP ratio is less. In that, our budget allocations are still very less. Our budget allocations to the health sector are still very less. So what is needed is that we have to increase our budget allocations to the health sector, as in Thailand. So for that, we might, you know, there's need to increase the tax, and also we have to see that there is no tax evasion. With that, we have to increase the budget allocations for the health sector as done in the Thailand. And next other thing is regarding the insurance. So insurance coverage, so one of the suggestion is that, you know, the employment state insurance scheme, the ESIS, it's basically now it's only mandated for the people in the lower income. So it's a mandatory only for the lower income groups. The one suggestion is that this employment state insurance scheme should be extended to include all the income groups. And other suggestion is, you know, it should be mandatory for all the citizens to be enrolled in either central or state insurance schemes. So it should be made mandatory for all the citizens to get themselves enrolled in the state or national health insurance schemes, as done in the China, South Korea, Kyrgyzstan, etc. You know, by doing this, you know, we will also include the unorganized sector into the insurance pool. So this is the one of the best plan to include the unorganized sector into the insurance pool. Now coming to the second reason, that is the regulation on the health system. So many world countries like Japan, South Korea, etc., even though they do not contribute, they are not the health provider in the health sectors, but, you know, they have the direct control. They have the direct control on the health system. So what India can do is that India should control the fees prescribed by the doctors and the hospitals. So there should be a control on the fees prescribed by the doctors and the hospitals, and also regarding the treatment protocol. So this ensures that, you know, there's some standard set in throughout the country, and the poor not exploited due to the charging of the huge fees by the private hospitals or the private practitioners. Now, other thing is that the licensing system for the hospitals. So as done in the, you know, it will be similar to the US certificate of need process in the US. So US has something called certificate of need process, which is nothing but a grant license to the hospitals. Now in India, as we provide license to the banks. So as we provide license to the banks, we also put condition that they have to open there at least 1/4 of their branches in the rural areas or the unserved areas. So similarly, there should be a licensing to the hospitals with a condition that they are open, you know, they open their hospitals in the areas which are not served. So in the poorly served areas. So this will lead to the equitable distributions of the hospitals. So, okay, that's it. This was the basic summary of this editorial. I hope you have found this editorial useful. If so, please like and subscribe to my channel, and also give me your feedback. I know there are delays in posting my video. I'm extremely sorry for that. I try to be as regular as possible.